I'm the RPG chick. This is a, well, let's play series that you get to choose at the end what is to happen going forward into the next episode. And the majority of you chose to hail the figures. I'm going to just do a quick reset here because I'm having problems with audio-video desync. Okay. You stop suddenly as you notice a movement in the distance. Three shapes are approaching rapidly across the plain, throwing up a thick cloud of dust as they move. As you watch, they turn and head towards you. So the majority said, hail them. So I'm going to hail them. You raise a hand to... Okay, that doesn't look friendly. You raise a hand to hail the approaching figures to discover they are tall, thick-set centaurs. Ho there, stranger, calls their leader, pulling himself up to a halt. We are Backlands horsemen. Okay, maybe they are friendly. That would be an insult. Greetings. The centaur unslings a bow and fires an arrow into the dirt by your feet as a warning to come no closer. He notches a second arrow, aiming somewhat higher this time. Now tell me, what is your purpose here in the living misery that is Badubak? I'm on a mission, you reply boldly. A mission? The centaur laughs. What mission could take you out here? There's nothing here to find. I'm on my way to Menpeng. As soon as the words leave your lips, you see the effect. The two remaining centaurs stiffen up. The centaur at the back of the group canters forward. That must be her, he mutters. Not quiet enough for you not to hear. The one the serpent spoke of. Stop me, I'll try to kill you. You have spoken to the serpents? You demand? I don't want to demand. Hand falling to your sword hilt. If these creatures are in the pay of the Archmage, they are no friend of ours, the centaur replies, cantering around you as he speaks. But we would not have them as our enemies either. They are fearsome. Perhaps we can help each other, you suggest carefully. I may have something you want. The centaur raises one thick, bushy eyebrow. And what do you suggest? He'll be in your live. Oh, God. A luck spell? What? Can I cast a luck spell? I don't want to tell them that unless I can't cast a luck spell. I can pay them a little gold. Don't have that much. What's a luck? I don't remember even coming across a luck spell. Looking. Somehow I don't think casting a luck spell would be worth it either to them. Enhanced, no. No. I don't see a luck spell in here. So that would be a lie then. Unless I'm incorrect. Unless it's detect trap, it's... no. Psychic info. I have the swindle stones. Alright. I'm really not that good at this. But I'd really rather hold on to my gold. I don't know how much I'd end up giving them. Do you play swindle stones? The centaur laughs. Oh no, he replies. I know the people of Carrie are happy to lose their homes to that game, but I will not. I can pay you. Our price for aid is 5 gold pieces, the centaur replies. That seems fair. Cool. I haven't been using my gold pieces lately anyway. You toss them your gold. You have clearly piqued his interest. And what do you want from us, from this sum? Let me ride on you. All the above. Tell me of the serpents. Happily, we tell you everything, the head centaur replies with a booming laugh. Every woman deserves to know how she will die. Do you know the serpent's weaknesses? The centaur shakes his mane. You mistake us. We patrol these plains, but we are not wizards. We do not know the ways of magic. But perhaps you have heard something, you suggest. We know little, the centaur replies, except that the earth serpent must stay in touch with the ground. You nod your head in thanks. The furthest centaur kicks the ground and grumbles, clearly unhappy that they are talking to you. Where can I find the serpents? The serpents have scattered across the plains, the centaur replies, and some are rushing to Manpang to deliver their message, while others lie in wait to hunt you down. The moon serpent is near there, one of the other centaurs says, in the mountains to the east. I just defeated the moon serpent, I believe last episode it was. I need to find them all. The centaurs nod. That might yet be possible. The backlands are a strange place. They shift and change. The very earth itself is cursed. Many who try to rush across find themselves only turning in circles. The serpents have crossed once before, but they may be slow in returning. The centaurs are looking increasingly restless. Well, that wasn't worth our money. They didn't tell me anything. The earth serpent must stay in touch with the ground. That's all we know. Thank you, you nod. You've been most helpful. The centaurs bow their heads and wait for you to go. The arrow fired by the centaur into the dirt is still here. I'm not going to take it or risk angering them. They're waiting for me. They're, like, watching me, so I'm going to move on. You nod in farewell to the centaurs. You continue to march. You have found 2 new clues. Yay! Is it something? The earth serpent becomes weakened when it loses contact with the ground. And that's it, really. This is probably the other new clue, but we already defeated it. Huh, the Serpent of Time, and there's nothing here. Oh, know the weakness of the Serpent of Time? Which is what? Okay. Not sure that was worth 5 gold pieces. I was worried it would be more, though, so... In all fairness. We have been to both these areas. We've pretty much been to everything southwards of here. Here we didn't seem to be able to do much with. So we will go north. You step off the road and cut across the windswept plain. The sun is hot now. A little distance back from the old road, there is a deep pit in the ground. A strange wailing noise comes from inside. Sounds great. Listen. You pause to listen to the sound. It is a musical sound, the playing of a pipe of some kind, but the tune is unlike anything you have ever heard before. It seems to coil around itself, and the player does not seem to pause for breath. Okay. Coil around itself makes me think serpent. I have to investigate. Getting closer. Oh. You stride over to the pit and peer in over the edge. As the bottom squats, a thin, dark-skinned man is playing a pipe, and in front of him, half a dozen snakes are writhing and dancing in the air. He has not yet noticed you. I kind of want to cast a spell to figure out if there's danger, but that costs... Yeah, that costs stamina. Call down a greeting? Greeting, strange creature, you call down. The man looks up sharply and pulls the pipe from his mouth. A visitor, won't you join us, stranger? He is part snake as well. Are those snakes dangerous? You ask cautiously. Not to me, he replies with a crooked smile, but even as he speaks they seem to be growing restless, turning and twisting in the pit. Shh, he soothes them. My slithery sisters, shh. I'll stay up here, you call down. The charmer frowns, then cups... what? Then cups one piggy little ear in a hand. What's that? He hisses. You say something? Well, I'm not falling for that. You reply, shaking your head. The snake charmer giggles. Too clevers, too clevers. He smiles broadly. The snakes ooze and coil around the man's legs. Those are not the Seven Serpents, at least I don't think so. Maybe he's one of the Seven Serpents. Tell me about yourself. He bows from his squatting position. Manada, the snake charmer, he says. That is all there is to know about me. Then he turns his pipe around to point. But who are yous? Who are yous? Just in case. The snakes are aware that of who I am. Even the centaurs are aware of who I am. So I'm going to say I'm from Kari instead of Annaland. Excuse me. You lie cautiously. Manetta narrows his eyes. Your voice doesn't sound like Kari. Sounds to me like further south. You're mistaken. The snakes in the pit coil and hiss. Manetta whistles an airy tune through his teeth. Are those the Seven Serpents? These... my sisters? No, no, no. The Seven Serpents are much bigger. Yes, much bigger. One of the snakes is climbing the edge of the pit toward you. Do I dare? Tell me about the Seven Serpents. You say, since serpents are your profession. Manetta shrugs. I know a lot about serpents, he remarks. What do you want to know? Do you know where the serpents are? Ah, hello. Manetta shrugs and flicks his pipe. Out in the wastes, he says carelessly. Who knows where? Suddenly one of the snakes reaches the edge of the pit and wraps itself around your leg and hauls you down into the pit. Great. You whip your long sword from its sheath as the first of the serpents darts in to attack. Oh, damn it. Oh my god. The pit snake spits at the air between you. You chop out, aiming to slice the creature to pieces, as it also shoots at you, sinking its fangs into your leg. You hold yourself as the pit snake moves, foolishly showing its neck. Then you attack immediately. You cleave the air with your sword. The snake hisses as it dies. 4 stamina loss. Rough going. I'm going to try again because we're probably going to face another one. Defend. And then... cut. I didn't have to do anywhere near that much. pit snake shifts, carelessly revealing its neck. Then you attack. You split the air with your blade. The snake hisses as it dies. 2 stamina lost. Decent dueling. Now I have to fight this thing and everyone else. The next snake is close behind. The pit snake spreads its jaws wide. You lash out carelessly, aiming to chop the creature down as it also launches at you. The snake is weakening. Now, stop that. Oh, I didn't lose anything. Awesome. The pit snake turns, but you won't let it go. Risking all your weight, you lunge for the beast's neck. The snake hisses as it dies. No stamina lost. Flawless fighting. Now, are you going to send all your snakes? I have to kill all of them? Or are you going to, like, give up after a while? No, not yet. Another serpent is coiling around your feet. Damn it. I'm going to charge. The pit snake spreads its jaws wide. You lash, aiming to slice the creature to pieces as it coils back, smashing out with its tail. The snake is weakening. It looms and displays its cruel jaws. Oh crap, I lost that one. Then the pit snake is sliding across the pit toward you. Poisonous fangs are open wide. You try a slice across its belly, but it parries the blade with its hard tail tip. Then it knocks you with a movement of its coils, and its heavy coils come for your back, drawing a long wound down your arm. You feel yourself weakening. Should I defend? Oh my god, even defending I still took 2 points. You fall back. The pit snake goes to strike you over you with its thick neck, but you duck. You have barely any strength left. It spits across the pit floor. The pit snake shifts, carelessly opening its belly. Then you attack without delay. Fiercely you lunge for the beast's neck. The snake hisses as it dies. 6 stamina lost. Shameful. Let's try again. It really hit me harder. Oh, are you kidding me? The pit snake spreads its jaws wide. You drop into a defensive stance, stepping back as it slithers from you. It raises itself, showing its terrible bite. Damn you. You wait as the pit snake shifts, exposing its neck. Then you attack immediately. You cleave the air with your sword stroke. The snake hisses as it dies. No stamina loss. Flawless fighting. Now, at least with every new battle, we get all our stamina, you know, our attack strength back. There is one more snake left. Thrust. Gotcha. The pit snake snaps at the air. You lash, aiming to chop the creature down. The snake hisses as it dies. No stamina lost. Flawless fighting. Killing everything. The last of the snakes falls. The snake charmer curses you and attacks himself with clawed fingernails. You attacks yourself. It's not very good of you to do. I'm going to defend this time. Snake charmer comes at you, tongue flickering as he scratches out. You gather your wits and drop into a defensive crouch. Cut. Boom. The snake charmer reaches for his dangerous flute, and you waste no time, swinging with expert precision and all of your strength. He thinks better of his own attack and defends instead. Snake charmer curses at the blow. Ah, I've wasted a lot of attack power there. You keep up the pressure and rear back, bringing your sword down on his head. He raises his sword quickly to defend himself. The snake charmer starts wailing and cursing at you. You foul thing, he declares. I'm going to defend this time because I only have sideswipe. Good move. You drop into a defensive stance. The snake charmer tries to claw you down, but you turn his grasp aside. Cut. Damn. Kid seem to do a lot of damage. You spy an opening and go on the attack. You lash out with your blade. Tiny snake heads fall to the dirt. He yelps as he brings up his sword. The snake charmer can barely find his balance. Tiny snakes rain from his clothing like cut stitches. Should I defend? Defend one more time. Oh, crap! I should have hit him. You drop back. The snake charmer circles around you and almost trips over his own piles of rags. Cut. Sweet. He looks over his shoulder, and you seize the moment to strike, striking with terrible might. He parries, in with his eyes shut in fear. The snake charmer is whistling and hissing at you. The snake charmer starts wailing and panting for breath. I will eat your eyes, he screams. Oh, crap. Oof! Then he catches you off guard as you slice your blade around in a wide arc. The snake charmer hisses like a cobra in reply and swings for your neck. Dirt is in your eyes. You can barely stay upright. Too much of this and you will be food for his pets. I guess whenever he finds more. He starts wailing and shouting. Sss, he hisses. I'm gonna defend. Damn it. You shift into a crouch as the snake charmer comes at you wildly. You rebuff him. Now he's gone. You see an opening, an attack. You thrust, making swift progress across the dirt towards him. Finally, a strike lands home and deep. The snake charmer's hands rush to press the wound, and he curls up dramatically, howling and hissing, until he lies on the floor in a fetal ball, spitting to himself as he dies. 5 stamina lost? Shameful. I'm gonna try again, because, you know, 2 stamina. I'll defend this time. I hit him for 2 that time. You keep up the pressure and rear back, bringing your sword down on his head. He raises his sword quickly to defend himself. You drop into a defensive stance. The snake charmer tries to claw you down, but you turn his grasp aside. I think when this happened, he was tripping all over himself. Yeah. You foul thing. Gonna defend. Choice. I didn't have the attack power to defend that. You drop back as the snake charmer comes at you wildly. You rebuff him. He grasps for his flute, then turns his face your way and snarls. What are you gonna do with that flute? Better, right? Yep. 3 stamina lost. Competent combat. Still only got 4 stamina left. Continue. Can we get some food from these snakes? It is suddenly very quiet. Suddenly very quiet. You wipe the sweat from your brow and heave for breath. Search the snake charmer's body. Working quickly, you search the body of the snake charmer, uncovering a bottle of clear liquid. His flute is also still intact. Ooh, that's right. Something for a flute. If it's a bamboo flute, we can cast Jig Uncontrollable Dancing. Look at the bottle. I just don't want things to disappear. Okay, thank you. You shake the bottle. Whatever is inside looks like water, but it seems to sparkle with an incredible purity. You recognize the shine in this liquid's very heart. This is a vial of holy water. Cool, I got another one. Just in case, if I can only take one, because options seem to disappear, I'm taking the bottle. I will also, of course, want the flute. You take the vial of clear water. Okay, take the flute. You pocket the flute. It is made of a hollow bamboo. Sweet. And plays a clear and lilting note. Then you have had your fill. You want to spend more time in this... No more time in this bloody pit. You scramble back up to the surface. Whew, guys. Okay. 2 measures of holy water. Now this might... I'm not sure. There's a bamboo flute. I think that will heal our wounds, but there's a spell for that. I think. Let me see. Again, consulting my notes here that I've written down, because it's easier than, you know, flipping through all the spellbook pages. Yeah, that's pretty hairy. Resurrection spell. Holy water. I wonder when we'd need to use a resurrection spell. I mean, obviously not on ourselves, because I don't think you can cast spells when you're dead. Alright, moving onwards. I knew that was going to end badly. If I had food, I'd drink it right now. I just don't want to waste the... Even though I have two of them, I don't want to waste the, what do you call it? The holy water. I don't know if it really... I mean, I guess it works for healing or resurrection with the spell. So I'm not guessing, but... You make your way slow... You make your slow way across the endless wastes. Mid-afternoon heat makes the air damp. Scoured into the plain here are deep, curving ruts. From a cart? Perhaps? Most likely not. They curve backwards and forwards, so unless the driver was blind drunk or led by a maddened horse, such tracks would be impossible. Most likely they are the tracks of a snake, but the size is hard to comprehend. Each groove in the land is large enough to stand in, up to the height of your hip. Follow the tracks. I can't face one of those things yet. You follow the curving tracks backwards and forwards across the plain. They turn a little way southwards, but continue on towards the mountains. Well, maybe it leads to the snake... Ooh, what's that? I wonder if we can get in there. It might lead... That might be from the moon snake. The moon serpent. Oh. Across the track? Well, I wanted to check out the curve there, too. So we can only go this way. Oh. The tracks give out as the ground underfoot turns from dust to broken rocks at the foot of the eastern ridge. Sitting in the low rocks and humming to himself is a dwarf. Over his shoulder is a cloth string bag. This isn't the one we talked to, right? The illusionist? Look him over. You regard him with suspicion. It is strange to see a creature out here, alone on the plains, though he at least looks well-fed. The dwarf peers back. What are you? He demands. Are you here to rob me? I mean you no harm. Certainly, he replies, but you don't mean me no good either. I'll be warranted. As he talks, he slings his bag onto his lap and opens it up. From inside he removes a chunk of heavy blackened bread. You want some? He asks. Thank you. Oh, give me one stamina. You sit down on a rock close by the dwarf, and he hands you a chunk of bread. It is stale and dry, but still provides some nourishment. Hey, you know, when you have only 4 hit points, you can use every little bit you can get. Do you have any more food? Yeah, I'm tempted to ask that. What's your name? Mist, he replies. Stupid name for a dwarf. Dwarfs have no names like gutter paste, not names like Mist. But my parents thought there was something different, didn't they? He spits. What are you doing out here? You ask. Looking about, hoping for better. The dwarf eats his bread as he answers. Have you been to Dwarf Town in Kari? It's a hole. I wanted to break off on my own. Get away from all the fighting. The dwarf casts a quick, worried look behind him, up the mountain slope. Are you being chased? I hope not, he shivers. I tell you this, there's something evil at the top. What kind of something? He shakes his head. I have no idea, and I don't want to know. But whatever it is, it blots out the sun. probably is talking about the moon serpent. Is there any way across the mountains? I've been wandering this plain for 2 months, the dwarf answers, since I left Kare. Not found one yet. Do you have more food in that bag? You ask. The dwarf shrugs. Yes. Sell it to me. Got no use for gold, he replies. Can't eat gold. I will pay you handsomely. You can dress my dead body up nice, he replies, sarcastically, but starvation's not what I'm looking for. Okay. You change the subject. It is clear the dwarf will not part with any of his belongings. Do you play swindle stones? You ask, taking out the dice. The dwarf nods. I'll play her all right, but I won't stake anything. Got nothing to lose. Is there any sense in playing him, then? I only play for wagers, you reply, putting the dice away. The dwarf considers a moment, then grunts. All right, I'll bet one of my rations against one of yours. I don't have any food to bet, you reply. Then forget it, the dwarf says, and pushes your hand and the dice within it away. The dwarf gets to his feet. I'd better be moving on, he replies. You can stay out here forever. We might travel together. He screws up his nose at that. My rations will last twice as long without you, friend, he answers. You can head out and starve on your own. I'm going to take his bag, bid him farewell. Very well, you nod. You will also starve alone. That's not nice to say. You must keep moving, but your exertions have left you weak. Perhaps you should simply rest here for a few hours and regain some strength. Yes, I think that's a good idea. Sweet. Up to 8 now. You kneel down and rest. You feel a great peace. Hours pass. Night falls. You should find somewhere safe to sleep. The time has come to continue. I just rested, though. Well, let's go... We've been everywhere. Let's go this way. North. Across these foothills. You pick your way carefully over the rocks to the edge of an old road. The moon crawls across the heavens like a dull pearl. On and on you go, pausing every now and again to scout over the land ahead. Then suddenly, you stop. Something is moving over the next rise, approaching very fast. Deja vu, guys. Well, I don't have a hail option this time. You think I should wait and watch? Or hide at this point? I don't know. I'm kind of tempted to not make it a choice and just hide. But, yeah, let me know what you guys think. Wait and watch or hide. Just about done with this plane, at least here in the present time. Soon I'll be turning back the dial if I can. And, turning this towards the past, where this will be a verdant, lush valley. Hopefully find some food and some friends or something like that. But, yeah, let me know what you guys think. Leave your votes in the comments below. Por favor. Should I wait and watch or hide? Thanks so much, guys. And, endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.